Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints for the first 2022 show. And I know that some of you are dying to meet the real boss behind the scenes. And she's been begging to get in front of the camera. And that is none other than Joanne Erbes. Joe, welcome to the show.
Thanks, Mark. You know I do a lot of things for you, but being on the front side of the camera typically isn't one of them.
Yeah.
Many of you know me through the Facebook postings for Disability Viewpoints.
Yeah.
And I'm the person who typically brings the guests to the show and works with our co-hosts to make sure that they have their guests lined up. And so I typically work behind the scenes.
See, I told you she's the boss.
Nah, not really.
She
and
makes
I
us
encourage
all look
our
good.
Viewers, if they have a topic that they want to hear about, to please let us know, because we appreciate that feedback, whether it's on our Facebook page or whether it's by sending a direct email to disabilityviewpoints@gmail.com. Either way, excited to be here, and we've done some great shows together, you and I.
And also, one of the guests we're going to have today is Linda Lingen, who for most of the 12 years I was on the Minnesota State Council, so was she, and she had a state job, and she was just a riot, and Judy Sanders is just as much fun. So we're going to put out a lot of information today on the show.
Today, as you said, we have two really fantastic guests, Linda Lingen and Judy Sanders, who are volunteers with the Minnesota Statewide Independent Living Council. And they have a lot of information to share with us today about independent living and the philosophy of independent living. So I'm excited to have them here and to have them share information with us.
And by the way, before we go, happy 25th.
And you bet, Mark.
And it is the beginning of our 25th year here at Disability Viewpoints, and where everybody affiliated with the show is and should be pretty proud of the work that they've done, and they know who they are. And we'll probably introduce you to a few of those as the year goes on here. But we're going to come up with Disability Viewpoints, Linda Lingen and Judy Sanders, and have a great show coming up next on Disability Viewpoints. Please stay tuned.
We're going to talk about independent living and the independent living philosophy and why it's important. So before we get started with that, let's have Linda and Judy just do a really quick introduction.
My name is Linda Lingen, and I have been a member on the Minnesota Statewide Independent Living Council forever also, but I am winding up my six-year term this year. This is my final year. For 6 years, but
then what happens?
I have to stay off a year, I can reapply, which I probably will, so they'll never get rid of me.
Of course, that's Linda Lingen, all capital letters.
Absolutely, all capitals. I feel like independent living has come a long way in the past, since the early 90s when this movement really first began. And it's a movement that talks about choice, that everyone, people with disabilities as well as people without disabilities, need to have the choices of where they want to live, where they want to learn, where they want to play. They want to participate in their communities and offer all kinds of things that people with disabilities have been denied in the past. So this movement is very important to me in the fact that it deals with allowing people the same basic human rights, allowing people with disabilities to have those same rights as everybody else.
And that's a fact, and that's probably the way it should be. Yep. Judy Sanders, you're next. Can you?
All right, I can. I am Judy Sanders, and I am here in Minneapolis, Minnesota, And one of my claims to fame is I have been in the same apartment building since 1982. That's totally irrelevant to anything that we may talk about. But I've been here so long that I think they'll have to tear the building down around me when I go away or something. But anyway, I have been, as a blind person, I have been an advocate in the disability community. I started in Denver. And, you know, I've been blind all my life, but I didn't always know how important it was to organize.
So you're a Broncos fan?
Yes, I am. But, you know, I'm a Vikings fan first now.
There you go. That's the right thing. Now, that's the right thing to say on TV. Thank you.
At least in this city it is, yes. So anyway, I learned the importance of advocacy when I was getting ready to graduate from the University of Colorado, or do my last year, and I wanted to be a teacher. And the Denver Public Schools said, well, maybe you can be a teacher, but you can't teach in our school district because you won't pass our physical. The only way you'll pass it is if you have 20/40 vision and the better eye after correction. Well, I'm not going to come close to that requirement because I am totally blind. But I thought that was wrong. And I knew I could teach, I didn't know for sure because I'd never had done it. I thought I could. But I also thought, as in my young, naive self, that I would be so good at it that they would change their rules. I was certain of it. And it turned out that it didn't work out that way back then.
Because the ADA law wasn't around then?
Yes, that was part of it, but it wasn't so much that as I myself was not in a position to convince them to change it. And so I needed help that I didn't know I needed and didn't know was out there. I hadn't learned that yet. But I did, and eventually, this was through the National Federation of the Blind, we challenged what they were doing, and I worked eventually as a substitute teacher there. And then I went on to other things, and I eventually ended up in Minnesota, where I've had interesting careers. One of them was working for a Minnesota congressman, and I was lucky because he was the first member, his name was Jerry Sikorsky, and he was the first member of the House of Representatives to employ a blind person. Somebody in the Senate had done it before, but he was the first in the House to do it. And I didn't even know that when I first got my job there.
Judy, I want to ask you one question I'm thinking about. Uh-huh. When you lived in Colorado versus Minnesota, how did you find what you needed to be different? Was it better in this state, about the same as Colorado, or less than?
That's a little bit hard to judge because I was different. I was not as independent when I was in Colorado, but that was of my own making. One of the ways that a blind person can get around all by themselves is with a white cane. Or a dog, but mostly people would use a white cane, and I avoided that. I waited for someone to go with me, so that greatly decreased my independence and my involvement in society. And so some of the limitations that were put on me, I let happen.
Right.
And it wasn't till after I started teaching and learning more about what other blind people were doing for themselves that my life changed. So I don't know that I can compare the two places because of that.
Okay, and how about your employment possibilities within the house? Did you find that a great experience, or was it early on?
I was working in his Minnesota office.
Right.
So I wasn't on the Hill directly, although there were times when he had me go there a little bit, for, you know, to do whatever work we needed to do together. I started as a staff assistant, and I mostly was on the front desk answering the phone. And as I grew and he learned more about me and I him, eventually I was the director of his Minnesota office.
Great.
So he gave me every opportunity to grow, and he let me know if there were things he wanted me to do differently. He didn't think he didn't have to hold back and say, you know, pretend something was okay if it wasn't. Yeah.
Well, a feather in your cap, a real compliment to you, though.
Well, we were both lucky, maybe.
Yeah.
And I just want to add, Mark, that Judy has continued her advocacy with legislators as part of the IL Council. She's right in there.
Good for her. Good for you, Judy. I commend you for that. And Linda, let's hear about your illustrious career for a minute.
Oh, my illustrious career. Well, I spent my illustrious career at Minnesota State Services for the Blind in a variety of different positions.
She was my boss.
Yeah, really. Really, I was Judy's boss for a while.
She was my boss, too, for a while at the State Council.
She's just a boss year-round. Oh, but I don't know if I was your
boss. She was my real boss because I got paid.
I know it.
Yeah. You did. Yes. And as part of that tenure at Services for the Blind, I was involved in the independent living area of Services for the Blind, and we had to have a representative on the council. Now, I was there at the very beginning of what we affectionately called ourselves in the beginning, MILC, Minnesota Independent Living Council. That was the first name we went by. I will tell you, it was not easy getting one independent living council for the state of Minnesota. As you may or may not know, our state has two separate vocational rehabilitation agencies, Services for the Blind and Vocational Rehab Services. We each had our own independent living councils. Now, when the feds, in their inimitable wisdom, said, you can't do that anymore, you have to have one statewide independent living council. Well, it was a struggle. We had to have a facilitator from Chicago come in and help us finally work out all the kinks. I mean, the blind guys were upset because they didn't want to give up their autonomy of having their own council.
Yeah.
Voc Rehab Services, their constituents didn't want to give up their own council. So it took a facilitator to help us work through some of the issues we had.
Is that kind of the referee?
Yeah, kind of like. We needed it. I tell you, we had some knockdown, dragout arguments.
Yeah.
Arguments in that beginning struggles to get a single council. But we did. We did in the end, and I believe we've grown so much over since 91 when the first council began till today. I see just a 100,000% difference in how things operate. People get along, people are able to discuss issues, people are able to state differences of opinions. And not get all,
bent out of shape. Yeah.
Yeah,
I learned that too on the Minnesota State Council, and I think I grew because you were hearing different people's angles of maybe the same things that you went through in a different way. And then I got moved up to the Executive Council because you people felt sorry for me, probably. But that was a lot of fun, and I could administrate a little more. and do things like that, which is something that I very humbly say I'm used to. But I had great people in our council. And when you get the Executive Council, there's only a few of you. And so it was really a learning experience.
Well, and Mark, I would guess, I wasn't around when you when you thought they were all feeling sorry for you, so they accepted you in. But you know,
I'm teasing, of course.
I know that. But part of the independent living philosophy says that not only are we here to help each other, but each one of us has to earn our own stripes.
That's exactly right.
We can get help to do it along the way till we learn how, because we don't just know this stuff. We have to learn it. But we have to grow, and that's what things like this allow us
to do. You kind of find that in television, too, Judy. It kind of works that way. There's a lot of people to help you start to float, but at the end of the day, you either know it or you don't, and you got to be spot right on or you won't carry. And the majors used to use a sentence called, "It's all you." And that really meant it's time for you to step up to the plate and show us what you got. And that was a learning experience, too. So in all these facets, whether you're on television, State Council for Disability, working for the state, you're going to learn something every day. If you're not learning, you're not learning. If you're not learning, you're not living. And so from then on, after your careers, you obviously both wanted to continue your advocacy. So where did you go from there? And we'll start with Judy again.
Well, I eventually I retired, but I was doing the advocacy work that I do all along. And one of the, on the statewide independent living council, there are specific positions that exist, and there can only be so many people on it, and you have to be appointed by the governor of the state to be a member of it. You can't just join. This is not a membership thing like, you know, some organizations where you can pay dues and join it. You can't do that here. You can file an application and apply, and one of the designated positions is to be a liaison between this council, the Statewide Independent Living Council, and the State Rehabilitation Council for the Blind. And then there's another position for this council and Voc Rehab Council, Advisory Council. So there are those two positions, and I decided that I would apply for that, for the one to be the liaison on both councils. So that's what I'm doing now. I'm serving on both of them.
Great.
Now I am retired, and so is Linda. So now we're both, you know, ruling the world.
Linda retired?
Oh, you bet. Well, sort of, you know.
She's
retired from one thing, but...
I wore you out?
Well, like Judy, here I am. I'm the Statewide Independent Living Council, and I am the liaison from this council to the Vocational Rehabilitation Services Council. So I serve on both of those councils.
Good for you. Thanks for what you guys are doing. Well, my Minnesota State Council story is this. When Jesse Ventura was governor, I had applied 11 months earlier. The phone rang and they called me and asked if I was interested, and I forgot I applied because it was 11 months prior. But I said yes, and it rolled on for 12 years, and I'll tell you, I learned a lot, but I had a lot of fun, too, thanks to Linda Lingen and the gang that were on there. And I'd served on some other boards, too, United Cerebral Palsy. Joanne Erbes gave me a chance. The majors gave me a chance to be in front of the camera to train, and that was great. So I've had the best of all worlds, and thanks to you three on the air.
Yeah. Hey, Mark, I just want to clarify that we're talking about two different councils here.
Yeah.
The one that you keep referencing is the Minnesota Council on Disability. And they have a function of advocacy for people with disabilities, but advising also the governor.
Yep.
And so that is a governor-appointed council.
Yep.
The council that Judy and Linda are talking about is the Minnesota Statewide
I realize that.
And I just want to make sure that our viewers understand.
Our listeners
that,
to know.
And that the Statewide Independent Living Council, or MnSILC as it's now called, the name changed from MILC to MnSILC, Federally funded council with members appointed by the governor, and 51% of those individuals serving on the MnSilk council are required under federal law to be people with disabilities. So Minnesota is very excited to say that we have about 87% of our council members are people with disabilities who bring a very, very unique perspective to the council. And one of the council requirements is that we create the state plan for independent living, connecting with the 8 centers for independent living.
The state plan for independent living is a plan that is developed by a joint effort between the Centers for Independent Living, the MnSilk State Council, Statewide Independent Living Council, and the, as they fondly call it in federal language, the DSE, designated state entity, which currently is Vocational Rehabilitation Services. And State Services for the Blind is also actively involved. And so once every 3 years, we all get together and develop this state plan that helps us map out how we want to improve and increase services across the state of Minnesota for people with disabilities through the Centers for Independent Living. And you will see the map and you'll notice where the centers are located. There's one in Rochester, Mankato, Marshall, St. Paul, Sauk Rapids, Hibbing, East Grand Forks, and Fargo-Moorhead.
And we should say that the councils, for instance, the one in St. Paul serves the whole metropolitan area.
Right.
So right. Even if you don't live in St. Paul, you can get services.
Right.
So this plan, as Linda mentioned, is a 3-year plan. So the first year, the year before it's supposed to start, so we're on the last year of previous plan, we have to spend a lot of time writing it. And eventually we need the agreement of all the 8 councils as well, and they have their part in it, and the 2 agencies, State Services for the Blind and Vocational Rehabilitation. And so that all comes together in one big plan, and there are goals that we have in each plan, and then we check our progress as we go along. How are we doing on all this fine stuff we said we were going to do? So we have to review how we're doing as we do this.
Right.
We hold public hearings so that the disability community and anyone else interested in the disability community can weigh in and what they hope will happen and where do they see problems that they think need solving. We hear a lot about public transportation and we hear a lot about housing. Those are 2 main areas where
we
get a lot.
All of a sudden surplus of the state monies in the state of Minnesota, how do you think this will affect your plan with COVID and everything else going on in the state of Minnesota? Do you think it'll be a plus for you to try to get some extra money, or do you think you'll have a little bit of trouble?
Well, I don't know. If I had to guess, I'd say we might get some extra, but we also, I think both agencies had extra money because a lot of the ways in which we would have spent the money, we couldn't because of COVID.
Right.
Well, and just to let you know, Mark, that the Statewide Independent Living Council, is fully federally funded.
Right.
It's no state dollars. Right. The centers would get the state dollars.
That's what I was trying to figure get was the division thereof.
And they are asking, for some additional dollars, and we're hoping that we can help advocate on behalf of the centers and what they do to help legislators understand the importance of the centers.
Absolutely, and they got some real leading people on these committees. So a final thought before we go, we've got about 30 seconds.
So the website for Minnesota Statewide Independent Living Council is www.mnsilc.org.
Can you give me that one more time?
Okay, it's www.mnsilc.org.
Okay.
Our Facebook page is MNILNET, N-E-T. Mm-hmm. And you can always call, and Joe is the lucky person that gets to answer the phone.
Oh, and she's knowledge and power, baby.
Yes, and her number is 612-518-1497.
Give me that one again in case I can't sleep, then I can call it.
Okay, 612-518-1497.
Great. And Judy, do you have a final thought for us? We're going to have to go here in about 15 seconds.
Well, only to say that if you've been watching this and you are living with a disability and you've wondered, how can I do all this? Find your Center for Independent Living or find us and talk to somebody.
Very good. And thank you all for being here today. We compiled a lot of information in the last 30 minutes, and we hope you at home put it to good use. It was valuable information. There's a lot of things I know that I didn't know before we started this show. And Linda Lingen and I were on the State Council on Disabilities together. And I was there a whole 12 years, which by state law was all you could be on there. But it was just a blast. She is just one of the finest individuals I've ever met. And Judy Saunders, I've got equally as good things to say about. So we had two great guests today with a lot of information. And look it, you got to see my assistant, Joanne Erbes, live on the air. So there you are. So what a way to start off this series this coming year. Thank you, Joe, for being on.
Well, Mark, what I was going to say earlier is that people may know me behind the scenes, but I do also have a real job, if you will. I'm the coordinator for the Minnesota Statewide Independent Living Council. So I've had the pleasure of working with Linda and Judy for the last couple of years, and they are a wealth of information about independent living. So if I can share the website one more time.
Sure.
It's www.mnsilc.org. That's mensilc.org. Or the telephone number is 612-518-1497. If anyone has questions at any point in time, we look forward to hearing from you. And as we talked briefly, we are always in need of council members. So if people have questions about how to join the council, please give us a call. Send us
Well, that sounds great. And how Joanne Erbes and I really started on the show was the 50th anniversary in United Cerebral Palsy, Minnesota. Joanne was the executive director of that at one time. And it just started off great, and she really didn't want to leave me, so she stayed. and it's been a great thing for me, because without her, there probably wouldn't be a disability viewpoints into your homes all the times that there have been. So I can say wholehearted felt thanks.
Thanks, Mark, for having me. And again, let me just say, Disability Viewpoints email is Disability Viewpoints. All one word, at gmail.com. And we would love to hear from you as the viewers on anything that you might want on Disability Viewpoints. Thanks, Mark.
Yeah, and happy to the beginning of our 25th year. And for those of you at home, thanks for watching all these years. And Joe and I will see you again next time on Disability Viewpoints. Bye for now.